he meets him from a distance. And actually, in later interviews, Rodney King said he decided to pull over in front of an apartment building in the hope that somebody might see it and videotape it. This event intensified a long-standing perception in the black community that the LAPD engaged in racial discrimination. Slide. Just 2 weeks after the media firestorm generated by King's beating, anger over another case bubbled up. 15-year-old Natasha Harlins was shot and killed by Soon Jung-doo, a 51-year-old Korean immigrant owner of the Empire Store, after a dispute over a bottle of orange juice. A jury later found Doo guilty of voluntary manslaughter with a 16-year prison sentence recommendation. But on November 16, 1991, a judge sent Doo to probation, saying that she was in fear from earlier robberies. Sentence. And a surveillance video showing Natasha being shot from the back further inflamed racial tensions. Slide. 5 months after that, on April 29th, 1992, a Simi Valley jury composed of one Latino, one Asian American, and 10 white folk acquitted three of the police officers accused of beating Rodney King and were hung jury on one of the charges of the fourth officer. This is a famous picture of prominent black clergyman Chip Murray tearfully watching the Simi Valley verdict being announced. It reminds us, doesn't it, of Jesus weeping over the city. Because Chip, too, understood that injustice inevitably breeds violence. As we all know, within hours of that verdict, riots and looting exploded around LA County and spread to other cities around the country. Over the course of 4 days, 63 people lost their lives amid the looting and fires that ravaged the city. 10 people were shot to death by law enforcement. 53 others died in incidents tied to the rioting. The victims, 14 were white, 2 were Asian, a Vietnamese and a Korean, 28 were black, 19 were Latino. The rioting destroyed or damaged over 1,000 buildings in the Los Angeles area. Approximately 3,600 fires were set, with fire calls coming in once every minute at some points. The estimated cost of the damages was over $1 billion. Urban theorist Mike Davis called this part race rebellion against long simmering injustices, part postmodern urban bread riot. Almost 10,000 California National Guard troops were deployed to take control of the situation. And then 3 days after the violence began, federal troops, including Marines, were also sent into LA, some soldiers staying until May 27. Nearly 12,000 people were arrested, mostly directly related to the riot. Now, like some of you here, a few of you anyway, I was on the streets during those days, working with other activists to try to keep the peace while working for justice in Northwest Pasadena. The rioting was sporadic. So, as I said, this story is deeply personal for me, as it is for many of you. The events of Psyche Boo seared my conscience, in part because it was the second time that I'd seen my city burn. First time was August 11th to 15th, 1965, when LA burned for 3 days in reaction to, see if this sounds familiar, the beating of a black man by white cops after a traffic stop. I was 10 years old, but I can still remember the acrid smell of smoke in the air. The Watts Rebellion, though largely contained in South Central LA, was significant. 35 people were killed, 900 injured, property losses were $250,000, and again, federal troops were called in to occupy the city. Watts was one of a string of summer urban riots throughout the decade in the 1960s and became a national symbol for black unrest and white police suppression. It reminded the nation, if only for a moment, of the inevitable violence that sooner or later would erupt where and when injustice is justice is lacking, because we don't know the things that make for peace. A few days after the Watts fires burned down, Dr. Martin Luther King came to town to try to understand what had happened. King was deeply moved by the conversations he had here about systemic civil rights violations and economic and social discrimination. A riot, he said, is the language of the unheard. King's experience in LA figured prominently in his most prophetic sermon given less than 2 years later at Riverside Church in New York. This week, Art, we've been commemorating that great sermon because it's the 50th anniversary of his Beyond Vietnam, A Time to Break the Silence address. In it, King was prophetic in both senses of that word, speaking truth to power and anticipating the historical consequences of our collective choices. He recognized that disenfranchised inner-city youth who were rioting were only mirroring the violent behavior they saw in their nation around the world. The sermon was the culmination of King's lifetime struggle for the soul of America, and was his most consequential address. He was assassinated exactly 1 year, almost to the hour later. Indeed, his analysis remains disturbingly resonant today, which is why peace and justice circles all over the country have been organizing around this historic sermon. And we refer you to websites here to learn more about the sermon, especially the series that has been running through Lent on radicaldiscipleship.net, curated by Tom Airy back there. Tom, raise your hand. Take some credit. It's a great series, and you might want to review it. King began that speech lamenting the way that the Johnson administration's war on poverty had, quote, been broken and eviscerated as if it were some idle political plaything of a society gone mad on war. So I was increasingly compelled to see the war as the enemy of the poor and to attack it as such. King then named economic conscription. The poor had to fight and to die in extraordinarily high proportions relative to the rest of the population. We were taking black young men who had been crippled by our society and sending them 8,000 miles away to guarantee liberties in Southeast Asia, which they had not found in Southwest Georgia or East Harlem. Deeply impacted by recent urban uprisings, including Los Angeles, King summarized what he had seen in some of the most powerful rhetoric of the Riverside speech. As I walked among the desperate, rejected, and angry young men, slide please, I have told them that Molotov cocktails and rifles would not solve their problems. Slide please. But they asked, and rightly so, what about Vietnam? Their questions hit home, and I knew again that I could never again raise my voice against the violence of the oppressed in the ghettos without having first spoken clearly to the greatest purveyor of violence in the world today, my own government. We're having trouble advancing the slides here. I'll talk a little bit more about King's courageous address in a workshop tomorrow. But it's clear in reading the speech that he was looking past symptoms to root causes of the urban rebellion of Watts. And we can look deeper still. Two slides ahead, please. I want to try to summarize briefly some of the structural forces that made both LA rebellions inevitable. This is a picture of the famous San Andreas Fault, which shows, let's see if we can get the picture up. Having some challenges here. San Andreas Fault shows tortured bends and twists of geology due to tectonic forces. Elaine and I believe that this is a poignant metaphor for the traumatic labyrinths that marginalized people have had to navigate to survive throughout history. Beneath the surface soil, or built environment of every place, including Los Angeles, are strata of history and culture, most of which is traumatized. This means that in order to heal the place where we do ministry, we must build literacy in the stories held by that place. The deepest historic and cultural stratum to which we need to attend in this place, as in every other corner of North America, concerns the footprint of indigenous peoples. Slide in, how they were violently displaced by Spanish and Mexican and finally American colonization, beginning in the late 18th century, continuing until the present. This Holocaust has recently been documented by Native scholar Elias Castillo and Benjamin Madley's recent American Genocide. The second layer of traumatized ground on which we live is the history of how American annexation of California also displaced and marginalized its Mexican settler population, one of whom was my great-great-grandfather. The original name of Los Angeles was El Pueblo de Nuestra Señora La Reina de Los Ángeles sobre el Río de la Porciúncula. Say that three times real fast. And here's an interesting fact about the first group of Popalopes, or colonists, who came to Mexico. Of the 22 adults, one was mestizo, two were negros, eight were mulatos, nine were indios, and only two were European Spaniards. Those were the first Angelinos. So from the very beginning, this place exhibited multicultural roots, a defiant fact celebrated in Judy Baca's mural show. Which brings us to the third layer of historical trauma. Though LA may have begun as an experiment in multiculturalism, a flood of in-migration by white Americans began shortly after the completion of the Transcontinental Railroad in 1869. You've perhaps seen this famous image that so unabashedly proclaims progress as manifest destiny. Well, it was actually a railroad poster that sought to assure Easterners that it was safe now to settle. So successful was the marketing in California that its population doubled every decade. And by 1930, city fathers boasted Los Angeles was the whitest, most Protestant city in America. That upper right here is a fascinating tourist map of Los Angeles from 1940. The smaller legend at left lists the foreign colonies in Los Angeles, which include Negro neighborhoods, Chinese, Russian, Jewish, Korean, Filipino, Italian, Mexican, Indian, Serb, Czechoslovakian, Dutch, and Scandinavian immigrants. Those are all the foreign colonies. This map helped white Protestants safely navigate around the city and avoid these dangerous minority communities. And here we come to the modern day roots of LA's urban unrest. Speaking of maps, the tale of racial segregation in LA in the mid-20th century is really told by restrictive housing covenants. This is a map of LA before most of the freeways. If you were Mexican, you simply couldn't buy or rent a home west of the Los Angeles River. That's why East LA is synonymous with Latino culture, as you'll learn from Leonardo in his workshop. Similarly, if you were black, you couldn't go north of Adams, not to live, which is why South Central is synonymous with the African-American community. In other words, the social architecture of Los Angeles was determined by the white landed class, and immigrants and minorities had to conform or suffer the consequences. Throughout the middle of the last century, many neighborhoods around LA routinely practiced attaching restrictive housing covenants to property deeds. I used to live in Highland Park and was disturbed to discover that there once was a no Asians sign at the border of Highland Park. And South Pasadena, where I grew up, prohibited blacks and Mexicans from residing there for decades. And there were both official and unofficial initiatives that enforced these racist codes, such as the infamous so-called Zoot Suit riot during World War II, in which white servicemen roamed Echo Park beating up Mexicans, or of course, the internment of Japanese Americans. This is called social architecture, and it's the kind of spatial apartheid that further reinforced decades of redlining, the practice of banks refusing to do mortgage lending in certain neighborhoods, which was sometimes mandated by federal loan programs, as indicated in this 1935 document. Here's another structural fact. At least in the 1930s and 40s, if you were poor and restricted to certain racial ethnic neighborhoods, at least you could get to work, because LA had one of the nation's best rapid transit systems. Who knew? At its height, the old red car urban railway system had 25% more track than New York City subways have today. But that system began to be steadily dismantled by federal and city officials bowing to oil and automobile interests. which conspired to re-engineer LA's social architecture into the car culture it is today, a sad tale famously told in the 1988 film Who Framed Roger Rabbit? 1955, the year of my birth, was the last year the red cars ran regularly. And here's the rub. Watts had been a major red car stop. Folks from that neighborhood who could not afford a private automobile now were simply no longer able to get to work. Unemployment and poverty followed. It's no accident that Watts was a trigger point in 1965. A final root cause of poverty were so-called urban redevelopment strategies which attempted to clear out poor neighborhoods from the city core, such as Bunker Hill. The key to the remaking of the city was the construction of a massive freeway system beginning in the 1950s to accommodate car culture commuting for white-collar workers from increasingly far-flung suburbs. Freeways were rammed right through the poor communities, dividing and destroying them, particularly in East LA. In contrast, white affluent South Pasadena successfully fended off the completion of the 210 freeway for more than 60 years. These huge concreted corridors also effectively boundaried off poor communities. So here's a contemporary map, and again you see East LA, the 101, the 10, the 60, and the 610, and South Central, the 10, the 405, the 101, and the 105, corralled in by freeways. One of the reasons the 1992 uprising was so scary to white communities was because the rioting jumped the 10 freeway and headed north. If redlining was the neighborhood designed for segregation, its realities were enforced by the police, whose patterns of both discriminatory neglect and abuse is sometimes called blue lining. Interestingly, Malcolm X had been campaigning in LA in 1964 on issues of police violence, the year before the Watts Rebellion, famously giving this warning. This was an early version of the Black Lives Matter movement. These are the kind of root causes that Dr. King tried to name in the 60s, especially in his Beyond Vietnam sermon. The great rabbi, Abraham Joshua Heschel, the foremost voice in American Jewish peace and justice theology, marched many times with Dr. King. Just 10 days before King's assassination, challenged us to pay attention to his work and his witness. Martin Luther King is a voice, a vision, and a way, he said. The whole future of America will depend on the impact and influence of Dr. King. But we did not listen. And after the Watts riots, things continued to get worse in LA for the poor. This is a picture, slide, of Sweet Alice Harris, community organizer based in Watts since the 1950s, and the founder and executive director of Parents of Watts, still today a local youth outreach group. I met Sweet Alice at a 25th anniversary forum for the Watts riots. Deja vu. This was 1990. And she was asked by some academics why the riots broke out in 1965. And she simply said, because the cup of oppression just kept filling up and finally overflowed. And then she stopped and gave a hard stare out to the audience and said, and it's filling up again. And it's about to overflow again. Sure enough, less than 2 years later, LA burned again. And now we're commemorating the 25th anniversary of those events. And Sweet Alice will surely say, the cup of oppression is filling up again. And it's about to overflow again. You see, in LA, we've seen what happens. So let's learn from the hard catechism of history. This means that we need to do a much better job as churches, addressing systemic issues on one hand, and building genuine social relations across cultural and ethnic gulfs on the other. We need to unite people in constructive struggles for justice, not in constructive rage. A 2008 report to the Economic Roundtable by Michael Matsunaga summarizes for us a few facts that suffice to paint a stark portrait of LA today. Matsunaga concludes that there are four major areas of concern. One, Los Angeles is one of only two major metropolitan areas in which concentrated poverty became more prevalent since 1982. Second, the residents of these neighborhoods are disproportionately Latino and Black, and increasingly foreign-born persons who face language barriers. Third, people in these neighborhoods are less likely to be employed and more likely to be out of the labor force altogether. And fourth, these communities are unsurprisingly 70% more adversely impacted than the city as a whole by issues like housing insecurity, young adults at risk, maternal health outcomes, educational attainment, public safety. You'll have a chance to hear more about such social demographics if you attend Soyeon and Chip. Yongchun's choice of Chill Hold Lee's workshop tomorrow afternoon. So let me conclude by changing the metaphor from geology to horticulture to try to summarize this social snapshot by seeing how a tree's root system mirrors its visible branches. Of the many issues that could be highlighted, I've named in this brief overview five root causes that led inevitably to parallel social results. Colonial displacement, past and continuing impact of economically driven in-migration, century-restricted housing covenants that created apartheid, the eclipse of public transportation, and urban redevelopment on behalf of the rich, while deindustrialization ravaged the working class. These have all led to our current problems, such as the fruits of educational and housing, inequality, youth disenfranchisement, unemployment, etc. In this conference, we're focusing on aspects of Site-Igu 429 that are not widely recognized and understood, namely the impacts on the Korean community in Los Angeles. But let us be clear that the racial issues were and are symptoms, and we need to get to root causes. For example, the conflicts between Black and Korean communities in 1992 were in large part the result of racist social architecture and markets. It's problematic when the only medium of interface between two stressed and marginalized subcultures is that of a corner store, midst of an inner city food desert. Hardly surprising that Soon Jadu's Empire Liquor Market Deli was one of the first stores to burn in the riots. Retail economics is not an adequate medium for building cross-cultural relations. We need spiritual and relational resources. That is our calling. Which brings us back to the weeping Jesus. Our churches must draw on the biblical tradition of the weeping prophets. Jesus' lament of the city, which I began tonight, echoes Elisha weeping at the violence that he knew would be wrought by the king of Aram and his people. In 2 Kings 8, fire and violence and death. We also remember tonight Jeremiah, lamenting the coming destruction of Jerusalem and exile to Babylon in Jeremiah 9 and 13. True biblical prophecy is not about foretelling the future in a crystal ball, but understanding the consequences of bad collective behavior and speaking unpopular truths to those living in denial. This prophetic hope is echoed by one of our great American poets, written just before the Los Angeles uprising. History, wrote Maya Angelou in 1991, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived, but if faced with courage, need not be lived again.